and welcome to another episode of Breaking Mayberry : Bottle Episodes, the greatest entertainment podcast making fun of baby boomer television in the world. I'm one of your hosts. I'm Marty Schneider.
I'm that other host, Dan Ludwig.
And with us today, our new special guest for this journey through geniedom is an absolute treasure. We've had her on the show. She is a writer. She's a web series executive producer and personal assistant to Genevieve the dog, Jordana Lipsitz. I'm so happy you're here.
You have joined the elite people we have had on the show two times.
Wow.
Which I think is like you and one other guy.
Wow.
It's like the SNL Five Timers Club, except not nearly as exclusive, and you don't get to hang out with Alec Baldwin. Fine, because he sucks.
Who's in the five-member club?
So you got Alec Baldwin, Steve Martin, Justin Timberlake, Candace Bergen, I think Emma Stone is in there.
Who There's is only, Candace like, two... Bergen?
Murphy Brown.
Who is... No, I'm kidding. I've, like, heard of Murphy Brown, but I've never seen it.
Yeah, I'm in the same
boat. It's in the zeitgeist.
I know that she's... I know she's important, but I don't... I can't picture her face.
Is she a doctor?
Tom Hanks? No, Murphy Brown is about a female news anchor.
And she had a kid.
Oh, yeah! I've written articles about this for clickbait before.
Also, I think Alec Baldwin has been on SNL like 15 times. I think they just have to like regularly chase him away from the studio. Whenever his career starts to lull, he just starts trying to fight his way onto the set.
Oh, wow.
I'm looking at it. Alec Baldwin has hosted 16 times. John Goodman has hosted 12 times. Christopher Walken has hosted 7 times. This isn't that interesting.
Yeah, you can move
so
on.
So it's like that with us, but instead of it being like a testament to your like acting abilities, it's a testament to the fact that we remember your name multiple times a month.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Welcome to the Two Timers Club.
Woo!
Jordana, you two timer.
I'm number two. I'm number two. I think all right,
so we are, of course, going through I Dream of Jeannie. This one, we're doing guest choice. We'll get back to Andy Griffith eventually for the handful of people that watch this show and get really angry whenever we do non-Andy Griffith episodes. I don't understand. So today we are doing season 2, episode 23, The Greatest Entertainer in the World.
Picked by Jordana, and I think we should say up top, an absolute banger in terms of complete insanity.
One of the most bugfuck things I've ever seen. Like
I'm sorry, what? Bugfuck?
Yeah,
bugfuck.
This is
B-U-G.
F-U-C-K.
Great, yeah, okay, go on.
So,
like, so crazy that you fuck bugs.
In terms of, like, what the fuck per minute, this is definitely one of the highest things I've ever seen. Originally airs February 27th, written by Sidney Sheldon, directed by Claudio Guzman. Jordana, why did you pick this episode?
Because I'm a big Jew. But I am, and I love a convert, which is what Sammy Davis Junior was, who is the cameo in this episode.
Yes.
Guys in the audience in the future.
Mm-hmm.
Listener audience. I didn't know much about Sammy Davis Jr. before this episode, and I am obsessed with Sammy Davis Jr. now. What a cool guy!
Sammy Davis Jr.
Anyway,
I swear to God, I would do a cult for just Sammy Davis Jr.
You know what? The only thing I really knew about Sammy Davis Jr. were people doing Sammy Davis Jr. impressions. Hey, baby, you're beautiful, eh? And now that I've seen him like perform and do stuff on this. Those impressions suck shit. They don't make any sense. But, like, they don't give me really any context other than, like, he's a one-eyed, jazz singer who smokes a cigar. Mm. And honestly, the impressions always play up the one eye way more than he actually is in real life.
I didn't even notice he had one eye.
He has eyeball, like a glass eye. That's the word.
He's got a glass eye.
Okay. This is a pretty good glass eye.
He has one eyeball and one glass eye.
That makes him so much cooler.
I, too, am a big old Jew.
Oh, Marty, I always forget. Shalom, my brother. Anyway.
Mazel tov. But I too am a big old Jew, and that was kind of my reference point, was Sammy Davis Jr. was always like the like one other black Jew besides Lenny Kravitz that you can always point to. And the one that my grandmother absolutely adores, you know.
Can I share with you guys a tale that I learned about his eye and his conversion to Judaism?
Okay. Are they connected?
Yeah.
Like his eye is related to his conversion to Judaism? Yeah, let's drop that.
Yeah,
let's
bro. Okay.
Yeah, please tell me.
So here's the story. Here's the tea. He
dropping the tea on Sammy Davis Jr.
But it's not tea because people knew it. Okay, so he was raised by his Christian parents. His dad was a huge entertainer. They traveled around the world. Maybe not the world. They traveled around the country. Anyway.
They traveled.
Sammy Davis Sr.
Sammy Davis Sr. You guys have to read the full biography of his life because it is an entertainer from beginning to end. It's truly amazing.
From the little bit I know about Sammy Davis Jr., I have no doubt in my mind that every single moment of his life was fucking intense.
Yeah. Anyway.
All right, tell us about Sammy Davis Jr.'s missing eye.
So he got in a car accident, which is where he lost his eye, and then he was in the hospital because it was a pretty bad car accident, and he had this Jewish friend. I want to say his last name is Cohen, but I could just be surmising because, you know, it's a common Jewish name. Anyway.
Just going through the list of Jewish names and picking one. That sounds fine.
Yeah. You know, Cohen, Davis, Jewish names. So he talks to him about Judaism, and Sammy Davis Jr. realizes how much the African-American experience and Judaism, the stories in Judaism are pretty similar. He feels that way. And the interesting thing about that is that the Jewish people, there's a lot of stuff that's historically that's not actually what happened. So it's funny, but sure.
Yeah.
I do know that that is something that is big in African-American, almost evangelical communities, is the Book of Exodus. They are about as into the Book of Exodus as the Jews are, for obvious reasons.
It's a good book, you know?
Solid book. Solid story all around.
Bestseller.
Really the best book out of that collection of books, I'm just going to say. Either version.
Okay, honestly, I enjoyed Genesis a little more because there's a lot of dirty stories, but...
Oh, there's some weird shit there, too.
I like it. But... I'm a big fan. I love the beginning. Okay.
Genesis is nasty.
A Bible segue. Anyway, Sammy Davis Jr., I think that was the end, actually. It's just he found Judaism, and then he converted, and it was, really beautiful.
Ah! Sammy Davis Jr. was a black man in the 60s, with how hard that was, and then he said, I find Judaism so emotionally resonant, I'm going to make my life significantly harder by becoming Jewish also. I'm going to really kick this adversity up a notch because of my emotional connection to this people.
Wow.
Yeah,
he fucking rules.
Why are we talking so much about Sammy Davis Jr.? Because here is the one-sentence summary of this episode from Wikipedia.
Elegant transition.
Tony needs Sammy Davis Jr. to entertain for General Peterson's 10th anniversary at NASA, but he is previously booked. Jeannie comes to the rescue by creating a duplicate of Sammy.
Oh, that's the end of the fucking episode, Wikipedia!
Okay.
Damn it!
I have some thoughts about why these Wikipedia one-sentence summaries are always so a little off, and we'll get to it when I think we get to the cloning. But let's go ahead and start this John off.
Beautiful word. Thank you.
Jeannie is at the house, and she's magically, beating a rug while she's just, hanging out reading a magazine.
Inside? Why is she hanging it inside?
It is very clearly not his rug, because as soon as there's any noise, she makes it disappear. So, it wasn't actually serving any purpose whatsoever. She just wanted to hit a rug a little bit.
It's her rug. It's the rug she keeps inside the bottle.
It's her equivalent of playing a Game Boy.
Does she go back in the bottle?
Yeah, she's got, a whole lounge there. That's her room. Oh. That's her she-shed.
Yeah, it's, her apartment.
They didn't show it in this episode, but I remember that from when I watched this vaguely as a child on
let's ask that. Jordana, what is your experience with this show, with I Dream a Genie?
Yeah, I don't know, it was just on TV. I don't know, I watched TV a lot, you know. TV raised me, baby.
Good. All right. Simple. Simple and clean.
Thank you.
Right.
No. Okay. When you were a kid, what was your impression of I Dream of Jeannie? Into it? Not into it? Thought it was weird? Thought it ruled?
I think I really liked it because I really liked the Jeannie outfit. But now I'm like, why was a blonde woman the Jeannie? I mean, at the very least, they could have gone. Ugh.
I don't. Like Raquel Welch or something, at least.
A brunette?
Yeah, at least a brunette.
They actually did not want to have a blonde genie. They wanted in the original casting call, it was specifically not blonde because they didn't want that because NBC had a blonde witch on Bewitched.
Oh.
And they thought that it was going to be too close. So basically Barbara Eden punched and kicked her way into the role because they did not want her.
Empowered her way all the way to racism. Girl power.
So Jeannie is beating her rug, the rug that really ties the bottle together. So she's just hanging there, beating her rug, and that's not a euphemism. There's a knock at the door. So
actually, that would be a great euphemism for masturbation. That should probably get absorbed into the lexicon.
Kids, use that one from now on. So she makes the rug disappear.
Beating the rug?
Hashtag beating the rug.
Oh, boy.
Tweet at Ron Howard with...
I get that.
Deep cut for our longtime listeners. Enter Major Healy, who is Tony's best friend, who is one of the few people who's totally in on the thing and knows a genie is a genie.
I mean, he's one of three people on this show. Like, right. It is not a big cast.
So,
he's the other guy.
So Healy is wants to talk to Tony, but Tony's still in bed, or he's getting ready. And Healy's got to take care of the entertainment committee for the general's, like, 10-year, 20-year service anniversary. So
he
for their
refers
boss.
To it as his anniversary of being a general, which does not sound real.
Well, I definitely thought it was a birthday, even though I watched the episode literally twice.
It's so vague that you're not, like, they probably said birthday at some point because they were not trying.
It's a big celebration for the general, for which there needs to be some entertainment. And Jeannie, I want you to bear in mind that for this entire episode, all of this is because Jeannie volunteered for this. For no reason, basically. Jeannie says, Tony can do it. Tony can take care of the entertainment. We can put Tony onto the entertainment committee.
I should have written it down, but she says something that's like, what if another genie's master did it?
What if a... So, yeah. She says, okay, so when Roger was like, why do you want Tony to be in charge of the entertainment committee? She was like, well, what if another genie's master did it? He was like, yeah, which is insane because that indicates that Genie thinks that there's just like... Every dude has one of her.
Oh, see, I took it a little darker. I was thinking that I was like, the joke is that, like, men and women, like, when they're in a married couple, the man has a genie who is his wife.
Genie thinks that all women are genie?
Yeah, all women are genies. We're all, that's what she thinks the relationship is because that's what she sees. And it's a joke for the audience. They're like, hey, hey.
I sure am the master to my wife's genie.
Oh, God, it makes me feel so sick.
This is something that is interesting. So you picked an episode from season 2. Since we're kind of bouncing around with this miniseries, we're not watching a whole lot of development. But it really seems like Genie is a dumb, sexy baby in the earlier seasons.
Yeah, okay.
And she kind of becomes more of a person with, like, opinions and an attitude later on towards the end in like seasons 3 and 4, but yeah, she's definitely in kind of like sexy baby mode in this early season. Well, and I do not care for it.
In this episode, her stupid babiness is directly tied to her Middle Easternness. Like, she's like, I don't know how to use a fork and knife. What is that, like some kind of camel? Like, it's always like, she's always stupid directly in relation to her being from the Middle East.
Oh.
So in addition to being, like, a born sexy yesterday thing, it's also deeply tied to racism. It's so bad.
So Roger is, like, listen, this doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense for Tony to be on this. It doesn't matter if another genie's master does this. It's not a thing.
Also, he does not want this because every precedent shows that he does not want anything, really.
Yeah, so bear in mind, all of this is Genie's fault. She volunteered him for this for no reason. And then she threatens. Again, we're still not quite sure what Genie's power set is and what limit she has. But she threatens that if Major Nelson, if Tony does not join the committee, and put in charge of the committee, then on the night of the party, there will be a hurricane, a tidal wave, and a typhoon all at once. Genie threatens to level a city.
Yeah. She basically threatens to detonate a nuclear bomb in Cape Canaveral if she does not get her way. And it's not like a, like, wink, wink, nudge. Like, it's not like a funny joke where there's a laugh track. Genie just, like, looks at him and she's like, I'll fucking kill everybody if you don't do this for me right now.
So that my boyfriend can have this job that he doesn't want or know about.
Yeah. And I can't emphasize this enough. Don't tell him about it, because, again, I will kill everybody. If you tell him about it, he'll be so mad about this thing I think he wants to do. Again, I will slaughter thousands in the name of this goal. Genie threatens terrorism this episode.
In the first minute. We have not even gotten to the credits yet.
For this threat alone, Genie should be tried in The Hague. She threatens to violate the Geneva Convention.
She's probably, well, that's the issue, I guess. She's always going too big or too small because she doesn't understand how the world works.
Yeah, she doesn't understand
Genie and her war crimes. Wah, wah.
And she doesn't understand good or evil. Is she good or evil?
Oh, Genie is true chaotic neutral.
Okay.
If we're doing an alignment chart here, yeah, she's chaotic neutral, 100%.
If I was Tony, the thing I would have done by now is I would have sat her down and I probably would have, like, put up on a big whiteboard the words actions and consequences, and then I would have just pointed to them in rapid succession for, like, 45 minutes and just seen if that took at all. Because she very much does not seem to understand that doing things results in things?
I don't understand why she insists that Tony doesn't know that he's been volunteered for this.
No, yeah. She's like, he'll fucking hate this, that I did this. He's gonna be so mad and unhappy immediately. I hope he loves it.
So she wants Tony to find out when he gets to work. So, yeah, Tony walks out in his, like, little red bathrobe that's adorable. He looks like a Ken doll. It's hilarious.
Very cute.
And he's like, hey, Roger, sorry I'm late, I overslept. And Roger's like, yeah, you know what, dude, you should have stayed in bed. And then there's, again, a very weird, like, cut. It freezes right as he's, like, turning his head, so it's, like, super blurry. And then fade to commercial, come back to commercial. We are treated to approximately 45 seconds of stock footage of jets flying, while the most inappropriate, like, Mod Squad kind of, like, jazz lounge music plays in the background.
Yeah, it's so weird.
It's so weird. And then there's just, all of this is just to, like, set up a clip of Tony getting out of a jet to remind you that he is, in fact, a pilot, but he has no bearing on anything. And then he just walks into his office out of the jet.
Is he a pilot or an astronaut?
Well, most astronauts start as pilots, so...
No, but they think astronauts fly jets just around. Huh. They totally do not understand what an astronaut is at this point. They might think that you can fly a jet to space.
I mean...
That is my strong suspicion at this point, is that they think that's something you can
aren't
do.
Aren't we all in space, man?
I mean...
Yes. Yes, yeah. Technically we are all in space.
You got us there. Okay. We are technically in space right now, and therefore, yes, you can fly a jet into space.
I guess.
Checkmate, Jordana.
Thanks for that fucking stoner logic.
Damn it. Put one up on the board for Jordana absolutely dominating our conventional thoughts about space travel.
So, all of this was just a foil to get him to his office, and explain why he's wearing a giant orange NASA like jumpsuit pajamas. For that's it. And so back at the base, they're talking to Major Bellows. Roger and Tony are talking about it. Bellows thanks him for heading up the committee. And Tony's like, what committee? What? Why? How am I doing this?
Because he hasn't been given any heads up. So he's like, oh, hey, cool. I'm bewildered and upset. You know, like, because of course he is, because it's horrible to find out that you have a job that you didn't know you had a second ago. It's probably, like, the worst feeling in adult life.
We should point out that right before Tony got there, Roger and Bellows were talking, and Roger, at gunpoint from Jeannie, had to suggest to Bellows that Tony be put onto the committee. And Bellows was like, why? He doesn't want to do that. And Roger had to make up a lie that says, oh yeah, Tony knows all sorts of people in show business. He's got lots of connections. He'll be able to get us a great entertainer. And Bellows is like, okay, well, I was just going to ask, like, the Marine Corps band or, like, some local people to do it. But if Tony's got those great connections, sure, why not? And Tony comes in. Bellows is like, thanks for doing this. Don't fuck it up. Bye.
Can you imagine a worse hell than this exact moment? Because I kind of can't. Like, hey, welcome to work. Congratulations about that committee that you didn't know you were on. Hope you enjoy some piping hot responsibility. Like, I would just immediately walk into the ocean.
What's the, like, modern day equivalent? The modern day equivalent of this would be if you, like, got to work and found out that your boss's boss's boss was expecting you to bring Josh Groban to dinner, you know? Like,
yeah.
That's what would happen if you got to work and they were just like, by the way, if you can't get me Harry Connick Jr., you're fired.
Oh, wait, because they're both, like, crooners?
Norah yeah. Jones better be at our next banquet, dickhead.
So here's the interesting thing. I feel like crooners were... Okay, so now no. It's like your action hero is the one that we're so interested in, but I feel like then it was those guys.
This is not translating, because it is the equivalent of, like, hey, are you going to get Ariana Grande to come to our potluck or what?
Uh-huh. Was Sammy Davis Jr. Ariana Grande level at this
yes,
point?
Yes, dude. I was, as I Wikipedia'd, I learned yeah. that he was like Beyonce. They literally called him Beyonce. I was saying that as a joke, but like, I am sorry, Beyonce.
I'm only saying
entertainer.
You don't want to offend Beyonce.
In the world.
We don't need
which
that
is what they
thing.
Call her.
Frank Sinatra could come into your home in this time period, cut off the heads of your entire family, and you'd thank him. Like, they were living gods at this point.
The Rat Pack.
Yeah, the Rat Pack.
See, I'm only saying that.
If they wanted to.
I'm only asking because, like, the Rat Pack's height was the late 50s, early 60s. Ocean's 11 comes out in 1960. Sammy Davis Jr. kind of had his own show in, like, 65, 66. And according to Wikipedia, Davis's career slowed down in the late 60s, and then he came back with The Candyman in 1972. So this is 1967. You know, I'm just thinking, like, how big of a get Sammy Davis Jr. was to show up on I Dream of Jeannie. Like, was this kind of a lull in his career when he could show up on network sitcoms?
I mean, in
between major records or whatever. Because, again, just think about how batshit it is that this giant name is on network TV. It would be like, I don't know, Beyonce showing up on an episode of Modern Family.
Hold on, counterpoint. But he wasn't just, like, yeah, there's a lull in his, like, recording career, but I feel like he was at the Coca Cabana.
And, right. He was doing, like, yeah. lounge shows in Vegas. Shows.
And that's his whole thing, is that this episode was very, is kind of, like, tongue-in-cheek, we will find out, because he was known to work really, really hard and not stop working to the point that it was not healthy. People thought he would have breakdowns and stuff. A real Jew. Anyway.
So, yeah. So, we'll get into that in a second. So, Tony objects. Healy makes a joke here that I do not understand. So as Tony's objecting and Major Bellows like, yeah, it's great. You've got all those connections in show business. And Tony says something like, what are you talking about? I don't have any connections in show business. And Healy says, that's right. Most of them are married.
Yeah.
I don't get that. What is the single connection
in show business?
It's
a solid pun.
Tony says I don't have a single connection.
Sydney Sheldon.
Most of them are married. That's actually kind of clever. Good job,
that's
Dan.
Pretty good. Yeah. No, it's solid. It's subtle.
The writer is Sydney Sheldon. That is the name.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. He wrote he created the show and he wrote like most of these episodes.
Also a Jew. Just saying.
Yeah.
Anyway, go on.
Listen, you don't want to take too much credit for this show on behalf of your people. This pretty racist.
Oh, good point.
It also wasn't that difficult to find a Jew creating a television show in 1967. It's not...
You know, I just like to shout out...
You don't get bonus points for that.
I just like to shout him out. I hear about him. I'm like, that's one of ours. Even if it's a bad person, like Jared Kushner.
Whenever Jared Kushner is mentioned, Jordana just yells like, that's ours. Sorry.
You know, the nice thing about being a Jew is if there's ever a lull in the conversation, like you don't know... like, what to talk to your grandma about, you can always just say, you know who else is Jewish? Harrison Ford!
A quarter Jewish. What? Not too shabby.
A quarter Jewish. Yeah.
Wait, Harrison Ford is Jewish?
A quarter Jewish,
Not too shabby.
So, because of that, I've had to Google, like, just, if I'm visiting my grandma, I can be like, I gotta have some names at the top of my head.
Wait, is this real?
You type in list of Jews, and then you gotta be careful with that, because there's only two kinds of people that keep lists of Jews. One is Jews, the other is people who really, really, really don't like Jews. And those are the only two people that keep lists of Jews. So you gotta be careful with your search results there. Incognito mode, Wikipedia, list of famous Jews.
I mean, the tough place you get into is that the anti-Semites are keeping much more meticulous records. Like, they have names.
Than my grandmother? I think not. I think not, sir.
Oh my god.
You gotta understand that all my grandmother and her friends do is play Mahjong and come up with a list of famous Jews all day.
Grandma Schneider has an ofrenda of Jewish celebrities.
Can you give me one more, like, surprise Jewish person, just, like, for the road?
Paul Rudd. So, anyway, of course, Tony figures out...
Scene two!
Tony figures out, shit, Jeannie did this. Oh, there's also a little bit here where Roger and Tony are talking about it, and, Roger says, well, there's no problem. Jeannie can help. Jeannie's probably got all sorts of connections in the show business. Tony points out accurately that all of Jeannie's connections are 2,000 years old. And that, you know, her connections will always be like, I don't know, William Shakespeare will show up. And then Ben-Hur will lead a chariot race. And then a bubble pops up, like a thought bubble above Roger's head, where he imagines a chariot race. And then he gets really into it. Like, cool, after Ben-Hur, we can have some gladiators. That's a whole... this chick right there, he gets really into it.
Yeah,
and
because
that's funny.
I like that part.
Ben-Hur a real person?
I think Ben-Hur is a like collective idea of people. I think right. Ben-Hur is a lot of different people.
Okay, I mean, I've seen the film in Catholic school, but didn't know if he was a real, like, an actual human.
Yeah, they establish that Jeannie can either A, create life, or B, bring people back from the dead, or C, warp human beings through time to bring them to the modern day world.
Jeannie is God.
She can rip human beings through time and space and reality and mortality.
There's an entire episode, and I don't know if we're gonna get to it, but there's an entire episode where they're in Hawaii and Jeannie brings King Kamehameha back into the modern day, and the first thing King Kamehameha does is go, this sucks. I'm going to take Hawaii back from these white people.
Whoa, that is racist. Yeah. What a weird episode.
It's a weird episode.
The revolution of Hawaii gets foiled because all the Hawaiians get too horny. It's pretty bad.
It's very weird. King Kamehameha is played by a very Italian man who also happened to be Barbara Eden's husband. So back at the base.
For some reason,
they just look at the newspaper. And it just says like Sammy Davis Junior playing two shows a night in Miami, and Tony says, "Oh, it'd be great if we could get Sammy Davis Junior." And this man doesn't understand the gift he's been given. Literally, all he has to say is, "I wish Sammy Davis Junior would play at the general's party. That's all he has to say, and the episode is done. Instead, yeah. Instead, he's
like, I'm gonna drive to Miami.
Yeah. There's also a little bit, so they're back at the house, and Jeannie does more sexy baby stuff, where she's like, of course I have connections in show business. I know hundreds of people in show business. Thousands of people in show business.
What's show business?
Oh, it's so bad.
Creepy.
And of course she does say, look, I can bring in Ben-Hur, and I can get Cleopatra's crew or whatever. It's so annoying, so dumb. Roger leaves the house. There's more of this weird, like, BDSM, like, relationship where she's like...
What fetish is this for? Because it has to be, like, creepy dudes who are like, I want a woman that's a dumb, sexy baby, but also she's a living god who can crush me with just a thought. Yeah, that's what gets me off.
And she says, like, are you very angry at me, master? God. And it's such a weird line, and I'm just like, that's a fucking line. That's a line that you say right before someone gets fucked.
Yeah.
So interesting thing here. I wrote in my phone notes that I realized at the time, and also I'm re-realizing as I'm rereading it again, that when I am like in a situation where I feel like I have wronged someone, I act just like Jeannie. And I was like, is this what TV taught me to do? Did Jeannie teach me how to behave? How much of it did I actually, like, take in? I don't know. It was a little scary for me.
Marty, park the episode. Like,
yeah, we don't have time to unpack all of that.
Yeah,
but we should unpack it a little.
Can we, Jordana, can you give us an example, please?
Okay. I don't know. It's just like, if... I feel like I've offended someone. I go, oh, I'm sorry. And I, like, act like I fucking roll over in a way that I felt was matching to this woman. And I think, and it feels like it's, like, a submissive thing, because I, like, women are, in this show, for sure, told that being, like, submissive but also, like, creepily dominant is, like, it's really creeped out, guys.
No, so, like, that actually kind of tracks, because, like, every single episode we've watched has had Barbara Eden basically go like, I'm sorry that I'm a stupid idiot who fucked up your life. However, can I repay you? Like, it has, like, at minimum, like, 2 Barbara Eden apologies per episode.
Or it's another way around where she gives, like, a sarcastic I'm sorry, but it's like, I completely intended to do this. You fucker. All of this was me doing this to you. It's a weird fucked up relationship.
It's very battle of the sexes.
We are having, I'm in talks right now for our next guest to come on, an actual sex therapist.
Ooh.
With a history in, a PhD in human sexuality, who is probably going to have some real interesting shit to say.
Nice.
We're going to put this to bed once and for all, whether or not this is a sexually progressive show or deeply regressive. Because it's...
The answer is going to be both.
yeah.
Hey, like, so many things, you know? Ugh.
So they talk about getting Sammy Davis Junior. They're back at the base. This like, house base thing gets really confusing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Tony says that he's going to go to Miami to try to get Sammy Davis Junior. He's not going to tell Jeannie because he's worried Jeannie will screw it up. But he's like, all right, I'm going to leave work early. I'm going to go to Miami. And he leaves. Major Bellows comes in. And then Roger does not cover for him at all. Roger's just like, oh yeah, he went to Miami to try to get Sammy Davis Jr. But apparently he says that word try, like, real small, because Bellows is just like, oh my god, Sammy Davis Jr. will be here? That's the general's favorite performer. Oh my god, I'm so glad that for sure Major Nelson is going to have Sammy Davis Jr. It's not like he's going there to ask. I'm just assuming that Sammy Davis Jr. has already agreed. No one correct me on this.
I'm loading a gun, and if Sammy Davis Jr. isn't here on Friday, I'm killing us all. That's the level of commitment. The decisions made up until this point have all been consistently insane. Like, Jeannie made an insane decision to get Tony into the situation. Tony's decision to not use Jeannie to get out of the situation is completely insane. Major Bellows, like, locking them into one of the most famous people in the world to perform, I really can't emphasize this enough, like a dinner, is also insane. So it's just like a fucking house of cards of nightmare logic that doesn't make any fucking sense. And then Tony goes to Miami.
Before that, he tricks Jeannie.
Oh, yeah.
He moves the clock forward so that she thinks it's 10 o'clock and he's getting ready for bed. Remember, they're not in a relationship at this point. They sleep in separate rooms. They're mostly, they're really like horny roommates.
Does she sleep in her lamp?
She sleeps in her lamp, yeah. Okay. Well, apparently she doesn't sleep at all in this episode.
She just fucking stares at his door while he's unconscious, like a fucking house cat. Yeah, but she just, like, watches his door. This honestly feels like a fucking horror movie, this scene.
Tony moves the clock forward. He tells Jeannie he's going to bed because it's 10 o'clock, and she's like, I thought it was only 8. My hourglass must be slow. Haha, it's... That's the joke. It's a living. Ha! Yeah. Fucking Flintstones-ass joke. So Tony pretends to go to sleep. Dan, you have in your notes that he, like, pulls off his pajama pants and he's wearing little shorts for some reason.
Why is he wearing little shorts?
I thought that, too. And then the second time I watched it, he's wearing pants, but he's got his pant legs rolled up to the knee so that they would, like, wouldn't show underneath his pajama robe.
Oh, that makes sense.
But it does look like he's wearing tiny little shorts.
Like, just little shorts. No, all right, so this is, like, this is a thing that you would have to do in a nightmare world. Like, where you have to, like, move your clock forward and sneak out of your window to escape, like, a monster that dominates your life.
In your own home, because she's sitting outside in a chair watching your bedroom door.
Yeah.
Supposedly all night?
Yeah. No, just stares at you. Like every time Tony has to go pee, like, Jeannie's there, watching, commenting on it, offering to magically drain all the piss from his bladder every single night.
Did he seem surprised, though? Like, when he opens the gate, or the door, I felt like he was surprised that she was there. So, has he known that she's there?
Either A, he didn't know that, like, Jeannie watches his door every night, or B, this is something out of character, and Jeannie doesn't watch the door every night, but she's doing it this night for some reason?
Hmm.
I don't know.
Again, this sounds hellish. Like, both of these options sound horrible, of like, oh, I guess tonight my omnipotent girlfriend is watching my door? Cool, love it. This is a thing that happens sometimes now. Wonderful that it's unpredictable, or so, he doesn't know that and he's discovering that this is his life.
So he drives down to Miami. The next scene, we are at, Dan, you say it's a recording studio. I think it's like his, like, penthouse suite, and they're just,
yeah,
he's at like a penthouse room at the hotel or whatever he's playing. He's got his musicians with him, and he's rehearsing, he's practicing. His manager and his piano player tell him, you've been rehearsing for hours, man. You need to stop. You need to get some sleep because you're going to have a nervous breakdown. Bear that in mind because it's going to come in handy later. Sammy's being kind of fussy about it. He's like, no. We're going to do it right. We're going to get it perfect. We're going to keep practicing because I'm Sammy Davis Jr., babe. Then this Tony just comes in while Sammy's doing The Girl from Ipanema. Which is a weird fucking song. I didn't realize how weird that song is.
Yeah, I never really listened to the lyrics until this viewing of it.
Apparently, like, pop music and lounge music at the time, you would just, like, add exclamations and just, like, not quite scat, but just, like, well, a little bit of scat. Kind of like how modern day hip-hop songs have just, like, ad-libs in there. Sammy Davis Jr. would just be like, here's the verse, boom, chicka, boom, chicka, boom, da, here's another line, boom, chicka, boom, chicka, boom.
Yeah, no, he just, like, when he's doing the song at the end, he just, like, inserts, like, a Western quote in there, completely unrelated.
Some very odd ad-libs that I absolutely love. But yeah, he's just prancing, he's just wandering around his room, singing The Girl from Ipanema, and then Tony just walks in, like, there's nothing about how he got there. There was nothing about, like...
He had to get past the doorman or whatever?
Like, did he just walk in and say, hey, I'd like to talk to Sammy Davis Jr.? Except something's gonna make... That'll make a little more sense in a second. So he walks in, the manager stops him and is like, hey, Sammy can't talk to you. He's rehearsing right now. Can I do something for you? I'm the manager.
Everyone is being so friendly and helpful. Like, honestly, Sammy Davis Jr.'s crew, premium crew, great crew. Like, yeah. All cool guys. I'd love to hang out with Sammy Davis Jr.'s crew.
So,
I want to hang out with Sammy Davis Jr. Oh my god.
Can we?
Guys, that dance, his dancing, like, reignited.
Oh my god, yeah, no, same here.
Wait, hang on, no, can we, I think, no, Dan.
You want to talk about our loins rustling for Sammy Davis Jr.?
This is a very horny for Sammy Davis Jr. episode.
Listen, halfway through this exact scene, Sammy Davis Jr. could have turned to the screen and just said, kill for me, go out and spill blood in my name, and I would have just been like, all right, well. Time to go do that, I guess.
He was a ridiculously handsome and charming man. Like,
oh my god, the way he moved his legs. Okay, that's it. Now I'm
no
done.
Jordana. Oh, elaborate.
No, god. Please don't elaborate.
No, but it was like it's like a just an amazing dancer, and like I mean, you know, sometimes like. I mean, that's it. Like sexy dancing is like set. Like it makes you think of sex. Like obviously, like I didn't invent that. So I was thinking about fucking Sammy Davis Jr.
All right. Literal zero judgment here.
Marty, were you not?
I wasn't thinking about fucking Sammy Davis Jr. Cause like, I would just disappoint him. Like,
so
I know the limits of my sexual prowess and they are not enough for Sammy Davis Jr. So
if you actually check the show notes for this episode, you'll see one bullet. Sammy Davis Jr. could wreck me. That's, like, right under the thing that his manager says.
So, this episode airs February 20th, 1967. So, what? November of 1967 would have had another massive baby boom 9 months later.
Also, Sammy Davis Jr., fucking great actor. Incredible actor.
He's so funny in this.
Yeah. He crushes. He really is. It's incredible. Like, I know, like, he's a lounge singer. They have to do a shitload of banter. They're very well-rounded entertainers. He's, like, at one point, he, like, thinks of something while talking to his manager, and he, like, leaps over a couch and, like, does not, like, skip it. You okay, Jordana?
you know what it is? Like, this episode, like, makes me believe, like, okay, yeah, I can understand why everyone was so hyped to see Sammy Davis Jr. Because sometimes, you ever notice that, like, whenever they have a special guest star in a television series, it's always someone who's a little bit past their prime, or someone that, like, no one was, like, they're always just like, woohoo, Donnie Osmond! I can't believe you showed up here right before the prom is tonight and Train's bus broke down!
Past their prime. But
the example I'm thinking of here, it's a batshit insane thing. It's the episode of Sabrina the Teenage Witch, the Melissa Joan Hart version. There's an episode of Sabrina the Teenage Witch that features the violent femmes. And everyone on the show who is supposed to be teenagers in the late 90s are super hyped to see the violent femmes. And there's no reason... why any teenager in 1999 would be super hype for the fucking violent femmes?
But also, whenever there's a guest star on a TV show, they're, like, extremely wooden. Like regardless of, like, how good of an actor or performer they are, they just come on and be like, hi, yes, I'm Donnie Osmond. I'm here to take you to the prom.
I love that Donny Osmond is our example.
Because Donny Osmond was, like, guest starred on a bunch of things I watched as a kid, and I was like, I don't know who this guy is, but he's helping Scooby-Doo solve mysteries right now.
especially when they are musicians, right?
Yeah.
Like, and they're not actors. This is, like, I watch this, and I'm like, yeah, I get it. This makes sense. I see why everyone's so... like, in-universe horny for this.
Sammy Davis Jr. grabs the camera of the show and is like, this is my show now. This is, you're all players on the Sammy Davis Jr. show.
The greatest entertainer in the world.
Oh, that's where that came
from. Meanwhile, Tony's having a little discussion with the manager in the background. The manager's like, oh, I'm sorry, Sammy can't make it on Friday. He's booked solid. He does two shows a night until next May. He's not a dick about it. He's just like, yeah, man, Sammy would love to be there, but we can't. Sorry.
Yeah.
And the whole time that's happening, Sammy's dancing and singing, and he comes in and out of the frame multiple times, and Tony, like, reaches out to, like, tap him or, like, say something to him, and then Sammy, like, dances away. And I'm like, yeah, Tony, we'd also rather be looking at Sammy Davis Jr. than what's happening here. Like, you are also showing, like, my feelings. So anyway, Tony says, like, well, sorry, looks like I'm fucked, bye. And the manager says, who should I tell Sammy came by? Like, he's literally taking a message. He's not blowing him off. And
he's being super chill about this.
And Tony says, oh, you could tell him the late Major Tony Nelson came by.
Hardy,
har har, laugh. And then Sammy does the rest of the song, and he has this weird little dig at the monkeys. He ends it, and he's like, oh, well, not the monkeys, but it'll have to do. Hey, like, fuck you, the monkeys, who I think probably had a TV show on the opposite network around this time, probably.
I mean, I will say, who the fuck are the monkeys? Like, I've heard about them 10,000 times, and I could not tell you one of their songs if you put a gun to
it. Oh, Stepping Stone? Last Train to Clarksville? Hey, Hey, We're the Monkeys?
Like, nothing. Absolutely nothing.
Yeah, we are the monkeys. People say we're monkeys because we
monkeys. Is that the words of a song and not like a cereal commercial?
Let me explain to you who the monkeys are, Dan, because I've gotten yelled at about this before.
Okay.
The Monkees were a pop group around the same time as the rise of the Beatles in the early to mid 60s. And they were a boy band. They were kind of put together to be like a Beatles competitor. They also had like a variety show. They had their own version of A Hard Day's Night called Head, which is a surrealist masterpiece. It's a very weird movie, and I absolutely love it. It's genuinely funny. So they were a bunch of like kind of comedian bands who also sometimes just had this like new garage sound that fucking ruled. Stepping Stone like has some very early like garage punk fuzz to it. I am gonna go on record as saying that the first couple of Beatles albums and the first couple of Monkees albums are as good. They are on par with each other. Obviously the Beatles go on to do other great things and to be, you know, very interesting. But for that beginning bit, they are neck and neck.
All right.
And I have been screamed at by drunk old men in bars for this opinion for hours.
Just drunk berated old men for this. Fucking hate the monkeys. I retract my earlier disrespect of the monkeys.
Yeah, fucking show some respect for the monkeys. Anyway, so after the recording, everyone's like, okay, man, we're done. It's time for you to take a nap. And Sammy's like, all right, you're right. I'll get some sleep. And then he asks his manager, hey, who was that just came by? The manager goes, oh, it was Tony Nelson. And Sammy Davis Jr. is the first person on this show to have the appropriate response to this, which is, a fucking astronaut? An astronaut? Holy shit! What? An astronaut came to see me?
That guy's been in space!
Right, because remember, like, it's 1967. This guy is Neil Armstrong. That's how excited they are. Sammy Davis Jr. is like, no, man, I will make time to hang out with an actual real-life astronaut. He's been to space. He's going to the moon. I can make time for this. And
maybe.
Is supposedly going allegedly to the moon. He will be on set with Stanley Kubrick very soon.
I'll be clear.
Everyone here thinks that the moon landing was real, and also vaccines are good. You should have your kids vaccinated.
You know, I'm an actor, and I think I'm pretty good at it, but astronauts are the greatest actors of all.
It's really funny that we're doing this bit now, because we just released an episode today called Astronauts Ain't Shit. That was the last episode of bottle episodes that we did.
Oh, yeah, no, I'm just going to continue this. I don't think the moon landing really happened. I think we still haven't gotten up there.
Wait,
Dan, it please eludes don't.
Us.
Dan, wait, please don't. Dan is kidding. Dan is gaslighting you all. God, Dan, don't do this.
Just continue my thing of, like, fuck astronauts. You guys haven't really accomplished shit. Come at me, Buzz Aldrin.
He punch will. Me. He'll beat the shit out of you.
Punch that guy in the face.
Remember that when Buzz Aldrin punched that dude in the face? Some guy came up to him and was like, hey, you faked the moon landing? And Buzz Aldrin's just like, I'm 86 years old. Fuck you. And he punched that guy in the face. That was so cool.
I'm ready for it. I took karate as a kid. I'll fucking fight Buzz Aldrin.
I wonder if Tony Nelson would punch someone in the face.
Absolutely not.
He would like
good
punch.
Question? No.
He would definitely, if he did, he would definitely hurt his hand. He would absolutely keep his thumb in. Mm. Like, he does not know how to make it fit. Mm-hmm. Okay, so Sammy's like super pumped. He's like, go get him. Go find him. Because I want to hang out with an astronaut. Back at the house, Jeannie is yelling at herself in the mirror. And by that I mean, a second Jeannie appears in the mirror and is like, you stupid bitch.
You piece of shit.
This goes back to the previous, like, is there a bad Jeannie? Is she good? Is she bad? The bad Jeannie's
holy
in the fucking
shit.
Mirror, bro.
Yeah. No, she has, like, has this evil Jeannie, evil mirror Jeannie just been, like, happening in the background the entire time? Ugh. Like... are there internal genies battling within her?
Do we ever see this second genie ever again? I have no idea.
No, I mean, we've watched 8 episodes and she hasn't shown up in any of those 8 episodes.
I don't know. She goes to be in Mary Poppins after a while or something.
No, Mirror Genie just starts showing up in other shows. Like, she starts showing up on Three's Company and telling them that they're pieces of shit.
Mirror Genie just pops up in the Brady Bunch. Your wife is alive! She faked her death, you piece of shit.
Like, Mirror Genie pops up in Charlie's Angels. Like, are you spies or detectives? Fucking pick one! Alright, so Sammy Davis Jr. is excited to meet an astronaut. He's the
only person. I got one more. Mirror Genie pops up in the A-Team. Learn to shoot, you fucks. You were in Vietnam. How come you can't hit the broadside of a barn? We've just turned Mirror Genie into Shorzy. Mirror Genie's just Shorzy from Letterkenny now.
Do you think bullets are free?
So Sammy is like super hype. He's like, I can't believe I'm gonna meet an actual, and then Genie teleports him back to the house because Mirror Genie berated her until she could. She's like, you gotta do this. You better fix this. So she bings Sammy Davis Jr. to the house. And like in the middle of a sentence, I can't believe I'm about to meet a real live bing astronaut. And now he's in the house and he sees this woman in a harem costume. And he's like, okay, what the fuck? What is happening right now?
Okay, he immediately reacts realistically, which... Every time someone's been, like, teleported by Genie, their reaction has been like, oh, no, I don't like this. And he's like, oh, God, no, oh, I'm losing my mind. I've immediately given up on my sanity. Like, they break Sammy Davis Jr. In the fiction of this world, Sammy Davis Jr., had to stop being Sammy Davis Jr. because his brain broke.
Remember, they told Sammy that if he keeps working this hard, he's going to have a nervous breakdown. So Sammy's like, cool, I'm clearly having a nervous breakdown. And Jeannie's like, it's okay, just chill here, I'm going to go get my master. He's going to be really excited. She opens the door, Tony's not there.
She's upset that he's not there, and she just, like, sends a Sammy Davis Jr. who is... babbling and almost weeping. She's just like, all right, go back to where you came from. I'm done with you. I don't really see the point in you anymore. And then she just, you know, like, gets rid of this broken shell of a man.
Yeah, it just bings him back to the studio or the apartment or wherever he was. And Sammy goes to his manager and his band is like, you guys were right. I need to chill out. They do this funny bit that goes on a little too long, where he's like, I want to go to a sanitarium. I want to relax for like 3 months. And then it's like, I want there to be trees and it'd be quiet. But also, I think there should be go-go dancing and there should be cute girls and there should be drinks And you know what? That sounds just like the Copacabana. Let's just keep doing that. Let's do that anyway. Fine. Fuck it. Forget the whole thing. He talks himself out of going to it. He still thinks he's having a nervous breakdown, we should point out, though.
He just thinks a sanatorium would be kind of boring. Yeah. So that's the reason he doesn't do it. He's like, oh no, I'm definitely losing my mind. But yeah, sanatorium doesn't sound that much fun.
Yeah, he's like, whatever. It's fine. Yeah. Back to the house. Tony and Jeannie meet. Jeannie's mad that he stuck out and didn't tell her. They talk to each other. They recap the plot of the episode, basically. The next couple of scenes are kind of bullshit. It's just kind of recap. And the general comes into their office and says how important Sammy Davis Jr. is to him. That, like, he saw Sammy Davis Jr. the night that he was promoted. And it was so important. So he feels so excited to see him and so happy that Tony was doing this for him. Back to the house. Jeannie and Tony are now talking about it. Jeannie's like, well, you know what? Screw it. Let's try again. Blinks Sammy back. Sammy goes, oh, great. I'm here again. What the hell? And he says, hey, you're Tony Nelson. You're the astronaut. Guess what, bud? We're both going nuts. We're sharing the same delusion.
He's very upbeat about his nervous breakdown at this point.
Yeah, he's like, I'm riding with it. It's cool. Whatever.
Yeah. So Tony's way around this is to say, like, hey, you have been kidnapped by a top secret government program. We at the military have invented teleportation, and this is my sexy personal assistant. And Sammy Davis Jr. is like, oh, yeah, cool. Yeah,
I'm on board with all of this, sure. It's weird that you invented teleportation and used it to bring me to your personal house, but whatever, okay. Sammy's just rolling with it at this point.
It's weird that you used teleportation to bring me within the same state.
Yeah. And Tony says, cool, so listen, about that banquet. And Sammy's like, listen, man, I told you, I'd love to be there, but I can't. Which, by the way, like, Sammy Davis Jr. just learned that the government kidnapped him with teleportation technology, but he can't move a few dates around doing shows at a hotel. He still cannot break those. Those contracts are really clad. Like, he's
because
gonna
get the stones on this man.
He was in a lot of pain, honestly. Truly, that's another thing I learned about him. The IRS was after him. After the day he died. Uh-huh.
My thing was just going to be that Sammy Davis Jr. has a lot of balls, and he doesn't care what technology the military has. He keeps his fucking appointments.
So Sammy says, I'd do it if I could. I really would. And Jeannie says, do you promise? And Sammy's like, I promise. So she's like, cool. And she blinks and clones Sammy Davis Jr. There are now two Sammy Davis Juniors. And also, imagine... Was the Parent Trap out yet? Imagine watching this on TV. Because on TV in 1967, you'd be like, first you'd be like, holy shit, that rug is floating. But also, holy shit, there's two Sammy Davis Juniors on screen at the same time. What?
Just dad puts his foot clear through your box TV. He's just like, no! And just stomps through it.
Devil box! Stop showing these demon images!
Children, I need you to forget you ever saw that. All right. Man was not meant to exist as two.
I want to say something about this, though. I want to say something about this. One of the, recurring...
You sound like you're breaking down for a very real conversation.
One of the recurring
you're about to tell
bits...
us not to do drugs.
One of the recurring bits on Breaking Mayberry is that just the way stories are told on these shows... is so foreign to me. Right? And in any other show, in any other decade, Jeannie clone Sammy Davis Jr. would be the problem, not the resolution. That would be the episode. It would be like a Stefan Urkel on Family Matters kind of thing. Like, the episode would start, she would have cloned him within the first 10 minutes, and the rest of the episode would be like, there's two Sammy Davis Juniors! How do we keep people from finding out?
Sammy Davis Jr. 2 is going on a rampage. He's gone mad with power. How can we stop Sammy Davis Double Jr.?
In fact, that is literally a Gravity Falls episode from just a couple of years ago. And here it's just like, I'm going to clone Sammy Davis Jr. and everything's going to work out exactly as we wanted it to. this show, the Andy Griffith Show, does it too. They put so much effort into doing so little.
Jordana, what are your thoughts on there being two Sammy Davis Juniors?
It's evil. You can't just create, like, how does Sammy Davis Jr. feel that he has a clone of himself? Yeah. They damaged him for life.
He's accepted that he's insane now. Like, he's not fighting it anymore.
I have a very important question, and I want Jordana's opinion specifically.
Yeah.
Does Sammy Davis Jr. make out with himself?
It's so hard to keep my opinion to myself right now.
Okay, so I feel this is difficult, so I have, like, the pros for why I think he did, and the cons for why I think he did.
Jordana, take all the time you need on this decision.
Okay, pros. It seems like he would just, like, try it, you know? Why not? Also, he drank a lot, so chances are he and himself would get really drunk. On the other hand, the con list, I feel like there must have been quite a bit of self-loathing going on, right? So maybe he wouldn't want to fuck himself, which is so sad, because you should want to fuck yourself. I think
ideally we should all want to have sex with our clones.
This is baseline. Let's just all just clear it here. If we have clones, we're gonna try to hook up with our clones. Like that's just a given.
Yeah.
I think so. Yeah. Well, so that's this is the reason I feel so strongly about this. Like for a while, I wouldn't. Whenever someone asked me that question, I'd be like, "Ew, gross, no." And now, as I have grown to love myself through the art of Los Angeles clean living. Just kidding. But, like, truly, like, you know, I've grown up more. And I would fuck myself. So it's like, you know, it's the big part of it is self-love. Self-fuck.
So the question of, does Sammy Davis Jr. love himself enough to have sex with his clone? I like that this question started as make out with his clone, and we've just been like, no, Marty meant have sex with.
I mean, what, you're just going to stop at making out? Like, are you going to get to first,
it's just a first date. It's Sammy's first date with himself. And Sammy does not put out on the first date. He's not going to
cock tease himself, Marty.
Sammy Davis Jr. has known himself his whole life.
That's true.
Does his clone know everything he knows?
The benefit of hooking up with your own clone is you can go all the way on the first date. No, they 100% did hand jobs on the cab ride home.
No, but really, does the clone, like, do clones have your memories and stuff, or is it just like a blank shell?
So the clone, great question, the clone knew all of his music and all of his performing routines, indicating the clone had all of Sammy Davis Jr.'s memories up until that moment. Now, the clone also seemed a little bit cognitively impaired, so it seems like Genie hadn't done a good job of, like, making his brain. But he knew everything Sammy Davis Jr. knew. So
it was like she put a muffler on his brain.
Yeah.
It was just like he's sentient and cognizant and can do this much, but I'm going to put, like, a blocker on the part that would make the clone go, what the fuck?
The part of where the clone goes, I am! I exist!
Yeah, we're gonna stop you just before self-realization, because then that shit gets dangerous.
Right. But the clone does know how Sammy Davis Jr. likes to jerk off.
Yeah, sure. That's base instinct. That's lizard brain right there. That's like step one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Lizard brain's a really interesting thing. Thank you for expressing it in this conversation.
Okay, so
the conversation of podcasts.
So Genie clones Sammy Davis Jr. and then everything works. There's no problem. The next thing we're treated to two Sammy Davis Jr. performances, which is actually just one that they switch back and forth between the Cape Canaveral one, which looks like shit because it's held in like a banquet hall at NASA, and then the one at the Copa. And
the Cape Canaveral one is just like 8 dudes sitting in folding metal chairs just around Sammy Davis Jr. Like, it is insulting that Sammy Davis Jr. played this.
Here's a real question. Which one do you think did which? I think the clone went to Cape Canaveral, and I think Sammy Prime did his job.
Interesting. So based on his love of being an entertainer, I think you are correct.
But you...
Thanks to my knowledge of
Wikipedia. You do have to remember, Sammy Davis Jr. is super horny for astronauts. He's all about that shit.
That's true. That's interesting. True. Sammy may not have turned down the opportunity to hang out with a bunch of astronauts.
Yeah.
Maybe... Yeah, I'm going to change my vote. I think Sammy Prime did the Cape Canaveral one.
Yeah,
and was also probably like, what the hell is this? Yeah. You couldn't have put some streamers up or something? What the hell, guys?
I thought you guys Sammy had Davis a budget.
What's Sammy James Jr.? Is the clone called Sammy Davis Junior?
Yeah. Oh. Sammy Junior Davis Junior.
Okay, I got one. Semi Davis Jr.
Ooh, that's good. This
just makes
good.
It sound like he's a
lot of good stuff
erection.
Happening here. I just love hearing Sammy Davis Jr. in different forms. I would love a Sammy Davis Jr.
Oh, wait. Sammy Davis Jr.?
Oh, like French. Like
Sammy Davis Jr.?
Ooh.
Woof.
Okay, fine. That went on a little longer than it should have. Anyway, so that's it. Just a little bit. And then the general's like, thank you, Sammy, for coming to perform. This means so much to me. There's like a big shot of Genie being in Tony's pocket for some reason.
For some reason. No reason. It serves no purpose. It's not like a joke. It's just like a shot of her in his pocket for no reason.
Like, they had to build that giant pocket set. It was just such a waste of time. And then have Genie pop out, just be like, hi.
Whee!
Do you remember the premise of the show? I'm in it. And then just...
How could we forget you, Barbara?
Barbara Eden hasn't met her screen time requirements. Here I am.
And that's it. Everything's fine. They go back to the house. Everything's cool. The stinger is they recap everything. And then Sammy comes to the door and is just like, hey, guys, it's great to be here. That was a lot of fun. Kill my clone, please. Murder him, please.
He specifically says, can you... Get rid of this guy, and it's just like clone Sammy Davis Jr. just following him around, like snapping and singing. The craziest part of this episode, hands down.
Does the genie kill the clone? Does Tony?
You know what it is. You know what it is. Sammy Davis Jr. clone Jr. is a MODOK. He is a magical organism designed only for crooning. So that's it. It's just like all he does is wander around and sing and is just always on. Like, he's always in character as Sammy Davis Jr. And even Sammy's like, I'm sick of this shit.
Yeah. No, Sammy Davis Jr. comes in and be like, hey, can you guys Blade Runner my clone real fast?
Like, maybe instead they leave, like, keep him in a closet or something at their house, and he just, like, sings all the time.
Oh, Jordana, no, Jordana. Tony kills him with a shovel in the backyard. Yeah, yeah. No.
They let him go live somewhere else. Oh, he plays...
That's good, that's good.
Honestly, that would be the best thing is if, like, they're about to kill Sammy Davis Jr. too, and he's like... I gotta get out of here, and just, like, hops a fence and is gone, and Tony hunts him for, like, 4 weeks, but cannot find him because he has the brain of Sammy Davis Jr., and then just, like, starts performing in, like, Boca Raton as the best Sammy Davis Jr. impersonator this country has ever seen.
All right, I got another theory. Genie is about to magically eliminate Sammy Davis Duo, but instead...
That was the worst one we've done. Whatever.
Instead, Tony takes mercy on him and drives him out to the woods. And he's just like, go on, get out of here! And releases Sammy Davis Jr.'s clone into the wild. And if you go out into the woods out of Florida, you can still hear, out in the cliffs, who can take a sunrise? Sprinkle it with dew. So Sammy Davis Jr.'s clone just becomes like a cryptid out there. There's just out in the woods a Sammy Davis Jr. clone to this day, just living out there.
Wow. What a beautiful tale.
Oh, God.
And just, that's it. That's the episode, ladies and gentlemen.
Just the fugitive scene of clone Sammy Davis Jr. in that like rain tunnel, just going like, I performed with Frank Sinatra. I don't care. Oh, God.
So, Jordana, yeah. Did you like this episode? It sounds like you did.
Yeah, I liked it. I don't know. I didn't mean to, but I just, like, Sammy Davis Jr. really did it for me.
Do you think...
The rest yeah, I didn't
Do
like.
You think you like I Dream of Jeannie?
Okay. No. I don't think I would... Honestly, like, I remember enjoying it as a child, but I do not think that I could do a rewatch of it. I couldn't even rewatch MASH, so I don't know how you guys
Whoa, you can't rewatch MASH?
I can't. I mean, I tried to do it from the beginning, and I was just like, oh, so much toxic masculinity.
Oh, yeah, no, the early seasons are pretty rapey.
The movie's worse.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. A very rapey
Trapper
movie.
Is literally, like, his nickname comes from his habit of trapping women in bathrooms.
Yeah. Ooh,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It gets a lot better when BJ shows up, because...
Oh, yeah. BJ Honeycutt. Big fan of BJ Honeycutt.
Anyway,
shout out to BJ
Honeycutt. Everything good and pure in this world.
Welcome to MASH Chat.
Oh my God, do you want to do MASH Chat? Because it is 11:39 right now, and I'll talk until 2 a.m. I got some thoughts about MASH.
So all in all, Jordana, you would say,
let's do a MASH podcast.
Jordana, you want to do a spinoff with me? All right, cool.
So all in all, you would say you don't like I Dream of Jeannie.
I'm not
okay,
a fan.
Okay, not a fan. I don't know. I feel like I liked this episode because I was treated to two Sammy Davis Jr. performances. But otherwise, this is dog shit.
It makes no goddamn sense. And again, the main character threatens to do a war crime.
In the first minute.
Yeah.
And that's just the beginning of shit.
It's incredible. It's an incredibly batshit episode. We've been looking for a truly batshit episode of I Dream of Jeannie. And Jordana, you are the person that has struck gold.
You found it, baby.
Yeah.
You know, go where the Jew gold is. Ooh. That's what I like to say. That's what I... Too much?
Should we?
Marty's like, I'm going to edit that out.
I don't know. I kept in the lynching jokes in the last episode, so...
I mean, should we enforce that as an official policy for the show? Because I feel like that'll get us in trouble, Jordana.
What, going for the Jew gold?
No,
you shouldn't. Marty, you can. You
Marty,
cannot.
I'm going to defer to you on whether or not we should do that thing that Jordana said.
I'm going
to
sleep on it.
Okay.
Motherfucker. Okay. So that's about it. Jordana, thank you for finding this amazing piece of something. What do you got?
You know,
what do you
want to
plug?
Having me.
You got something to plug?
The web series that was mentioned in the introduction is not yet live, but let me tell you, when it is, it's going to be a real hoot and a half. So right now, all I really have to plug is my Instagram and Twitter handle, which is Lipsitz. That's Lipsitz. Then the letter in, and then N. And then the word giggles. So that's Lipsitz and giggles. Because I'm funny.
It's a very clever pun. Yep. Can you... So I have seen your upcoming YouTube show. I've seen, like, the pilot of it. Can you describe it at all, or is that still under wraps?
Oh, no, that's so nice. Yeah. Thank you.
It's fucking
so
great.
So the web series is about a girl named Lisa, and she does not have her shit together. In fact, it is called Lisa Needs a Therapist, and a lot of her neuroses is expressed via two puppets that are her logic puppet and her emotion puppet, and nobody else can see them, but she can, and they talk to her and give her advice. We are not launching the official web series for quite some time, but we will be launching some teasers shortly. And they are...
Where can people go to, like, follow and be updated and know when those things and get those teasers?
Oh, Come on, there's so many Instagram so far. You haven't set up the social media.
Okay,
yet.
Then
I can attest. I was their roommate when they were filming this pilot, and also when they were sewing together the puppet heads. I've seen the pilot. It's fucking hilarious.
There's gonna be stuff soon. Just
okay, wait. And Jordana makes an incredible puppet Freud.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah. Thank you.
So that's Jordana's whole jam. If you want, always remember, if you want to follow us on Twitter, we are at BreakMayberry. I am at Schneid Remarks. That's Schneid Remarks. Yeah, Jordana, you're not the only one who can make a pun with their name.
I didn't know our Twitter handles were in competition.
And Dan, you are?
I'm just at the Lutz. Mine's not a pun on anything.
Oh, you're just so nice, Dan. It's really nice.
I didn't really realize. Ludwig's a really common name, so there's not a lot of variations on it available.
Dan's the...
You know what else is a common name? What? Schneider.
Okay, Lipsitz. All right, okay.
Pretty common
right.
names.
I'm still amazed that I was able to get Schneid Remarks. Like, I'm never letting that go. We also are at facebook.com/breakingmayberry, twitter.com/breakmayberry. Instagram we have, it's Breaking Mayberry. It gets used very rarely. patreon.com/breakingmayberry if you want to help support us with your dollars for some reason. Special thanks to Jordana for coming on the show, and special thanks to y'all for listening. As always, please remember, you cannot put that genie back in the bottle.
Genie in a bottle, baby. Come, come, come on and let me out.